as the army moved, the civilians moved. So we got down there and they didn't have food for everybody. And then the Japanese were moving very fast. Manila had become an open city by that time. This was probably a month after the war started. Manila's an open city, which the Japs didn't recognize. They said, it doesn't mean anything to us. We don't belong to the Geneva Conference or whatever it was called at that time. But anyway, time, you know, was beginning to back. We were well established, they felt. I'm talking about the military planners, that we could hold them off for three, 4 or 5 months, knowing that sooner or later we couldn't hold any longer. The Japanese felt they could take the place in 45 days, which they didn't, and they lost many men trying to. But anyway, in the end, that's what we're building up to. We just, as in us, we had nothing left. We were on half ration, and whatever that would be, if it was horse or mule meat, that would be the meat that we get, or a monkey that we killed, or something, you know, just here and there, like you were living in the jungles. And that went on for, the Japs was stopped for about a month, and then Singapore fell. The British were defending Singapore. And they surrendered with 175,000 people. And then as soon as the Japanese could move out of Singapore into the Philippines, and our goose was cooked, so to speak, we lasted a very month. In December, or April 9th, 1942, is when we surrendered.
Did you know when the MacArthur Party left the island?
No. That was... I guess a very well kept secret for a little while, but once he was safe in Australia, then we knew about him, and they called him all kinds of names, and you know, just how young men have names for everything, and a lot of it didn't mean anything.
How did the Japanese organize the death march?
Mass confusion. They had no organization, and there's a place called Marvadales. That's down the very tip of that Bataan Peninsula. And that was the surrender. As soon as they could get past some of the roadblocks that was set up and some of the demolition area that slowed them down some, they come moving down toward Marvadales and up a little mountain there. And the first group that I saw coming up there was two or three Japanese tanks and an American tank with a rising sun on it. They had taken it, and this guy was driving it up the hill. So it started from that, and we moved maybe 4 or 5 miles up out of Bataan Peninsula and then go back 4 or 5 miles. That went on for a day or two. But the one thing that stuck with me more than anything else, you know, we've been at it so much, that we moved about halfway up the mountain, Marvadales Mountain, and stopped. It's dark. So I just laid down the ditch where I found out next day it was nothing but dust and had my head on a rock. Next morning, some Jap woke me up kicking me. And then we started from that, up Marvadales Mountain, coming out of Bataan. Group here, group there, group here, group there, yelling, squalling, shooting, bayoneting, just name it. And as it moved out a little out of the from Marvadales, there's a little town called Keb Kebin. There's an airport there, small airstrip running in out to the ocean. We were coming through that place, and the Japanese on the airport had artillery firing over on Corregidor, which was an island, a rock out in the ocean there, about 2.5, 3, 5 miles. And they were firing 105s and 155s guns. Corregidor was firing a gun that sounded like a train coming through the air. And the Japs got us all right in one spot. And I guess it's a blessing that our guns on Corregidor wasn't firing down low, they were firing high on the hill at the Japanese big guns, they're called 240s, And that's what they were firing on Kragador. So we were saved there. And as we crossed that airport, Japanese had guns in there, 105s and 155s, hub to hub. Men, Japanese men in gun pits with just a G-string on them. You know what? I don't know. Do you know what a G-string on them? And they was taking those hot shells and they were firing those things, flipping them with their hands out of the gun pits. And that was just like you roll and all the noise and all of that kind of stuff was the beginning of the march out of Bataan.
What provisions were you given prior to the march?
None. We were there, I don't know if you have, if you may have read or something about that, that the favorite saying on Bataan was, we're the banding bastards off Bataan. No mama, no pop, no Uncle Sam. And that's the way we've felt.
How far did you travel during each day?
Well, sometimes we traveled 10 miles and walked back 8. Back and forth, back and forth. But then you get wise to everything. You get wise to being shot at, you get wise to being beat on and all that kind of stuff. I started, along with a friend of mine, we would try to get into the, after you get out of on the Bataan Mountain, down into the valley, there's a lot of sugarcane fields. And it was impossible to see 5 feet in the sugarcane field. So we started sneaking out in the sugarcane field during the day and then crawling back out on the road during the night where we wouldn't get beat up and beat on and kicked at and everything on earth. So I don't know, I couldn't say how many miles we could travel a day, but it was about from Marvelis to San Fernando, that's the junction city where it goes on north and comes back to Manila. It took us about 10 days to make that trip. All the battling, carrying on, and Japanese soldiers in trucks coming by with clubs swinging at you along the way. But you, like I say, you learn to get out of the way. And as far as Americans were concerned, we were just dogs. We saw just skeletons of people where they run over with trucks and tanks. But this constant noise, every hour, less than every hour, you hear rifle fire. Men that couldn't make it anymore. I'm talking about soldiers that were just had malaria and all that stuff. You'd help and you'd help and you'd help and you'd help and your strength comes out after a while too. So if somebody fell out, then, I mean by falling out, you couldn't walk anymore.